vários anos, de várias formas. É coronel, foi professor dessa turma de planejamento urbano. Né? E começou quando o Leonel nos procurou, alguns anos atrás. A gente já fez várias iniciativas, já fui lá falar na universidade. O Leonel já trouxe uma oficina aqui para o Rio, onde a gente trabalhou com a comunidade Pica-Pau, em Condovil, que é uma comunidade muito, muito negligenciada pelo Estado. E a gente realizou alguns anos atrás umas oficinas lá de participação, de levantamento, de desafios e propondo soluções tecnológicas de tecnologia verde e outras. E depois a universidade veio, dois anos atrás, com esse grupo de alunos e a gente fez um intercâmbio muito parecido com o que aconteceu essa semana. Os alunos visitaram uma série de comunidades aqui do Rio para aprender com iniciativas locais, aprender com lideranças locais. E aí, no final, eles apresentam os resultados do curso da pesquisa deles sobre tecnologias e movimentos. No caso, dois anos atrás, o foco foi formas de organização, de mobilização, de resistência de comunidades de Nova York. Porque aqui no Rio, na época, estava passando uma fase importante de precisar resistir, né? Várias intervenções nas comunidades que a gente teve. E esse ano tem um foco diferente por conta da necessidade de solucionar desafios pontuais, específicos, importantes, principalmente a questão do saneamento e outras. E aí os alunos trouxeram algumas dessas soluções de Nova York para compartilhar hoje com a gente. Então eu vou passar para o Leonel antes, rapidinho, só avisando que a CONCAT, né, a gente atua há 17 anos em favelas aqui do Rio, a gente já trabalhou em mais de 200 comunidades. O nosso projeto mais conhecido é o Real Watch, que é um site de notícias de favela em português e inglês. Ele foi lançado em 2010 como um site para divulgar o ponto de vista dos moradores de favela sobre as transformações na cidade que estavam afetando suas comunidades. Também um site de denúncia de direitos humanos. Mas agora, com a Olimpíada tendo passado, que era o foco original do site, a gente está focando mais exatamente em soluções sustentáveis, incorporando já as qualidades das favelas, que são muitas qualidades de sustentabilidade ambiental que já existem em favelas do Rio. A gente quer melhorar, fortalecer, trazer mais visibilidade para isso, e enquanto a gente traz e troca mais soluções com outros lugares do mundo de onde a gente pode estar aprendendo. Então, vou passar para o Leandro. Obrigada.
First of all, thank you, Teresa, for keeping this going. I think it's already led to a lot of great conversations, this exchange, but it's also going to lead to a lot of great projects in the future. I feel like the people in this city have to deal with a lot, with a lot of support from the government, and there are alternatives to depending on government for their solutions. And I think what we're going to see here today is going to show you some alternatives that have been taken up by government in some cases in New York, because they've seen how well it's worked when it's been proposed by communities and by people and individuals. So it's a way for us to show you what could be if you can get a little bit of support, if you get some solutions that work and begin to convince government that, you know, maybe you should invest in this. And some of these infrastructures have not been fully implemented. Some of them actually work better here than they do in New York. But you'll see that, you know, there's a good future ahead if we just think broadly and we think flexibly. And I also want to thank Studio X, specifically Priscilla, Rodrigo, and Gabriela, and Pedro, who always host us whenever they want, whenever they can, whenever we want, really. We showed up last week and they just opened the doors for us, so it was pretty great. And everybody that hosted us today, and this week, and all of you, thank you.
I would like to echo all of Leonel's thanks to Studio X for having us, and also to Teresa and to CAPCOM and to some of the research collaborators, all of them, see some of them here, that engaged with us and shared your context and insight over the course of the last few days. And most of all, we'd like to thank the members of the communities that we visited for teaching us so much this week and for their engagement with us in this work. And it's really an honor and a privilege to get to share with you some of the things that we have been working on in New York. So, just to give you a little bit of context, has any of you or someone you know been to New York City? Okay, so it's a pretty large city in North America. To give you some comparisons, about two-thirds the size of Rio de Janeiro in terms of the area of the municipal center, the city boundary. So city of Rio to city of New York, Rio is bigger. It's located all surrounded by water. Sometimes we forget this, but it's there's a sea that meets a network of rivers, and the city of New York actually has three islands, Manhattan, Staten Island, and this Long Island, which has Queens and Brooklyn on it, are three of the islands, and only the Bronx is on the mainland of New York. But there are five boroughs, or counties, and it's a very dense city. And that density is concentrated in the island of Manhattan, as you can see here. It's also, like Rio, a very socially stratified city. The wealthier people are also in New York and in certain areas of Manhattan, in certain areas of Brooklyn. And if you look at the lighter colors, those are where the lower income people tend to live, and that is strongly correlated with racial composition as well. If you see those same areas, they're also the communities of large communities of color in New York City. So we're going to be sharing with you a few case studies of sustainable infrastructure projects that are being practiced right now in the city. These are where they are located. And as we began to study sustainable infrastructure, we notice that the way that people talk about infrastructure is often very separate. You talk about water, you talk about solid waste, you talk about energy, but this is kind of a mechanized or machine paradigm for thinking about a system. And in fact, this creates a lot of waste because it's linear. There's inputs and there's outputs. But in a more sustainable system that we're going to talk about today, some examples, there's a lot more, it's more like an organism. The outputs of something become useful inputs in something else. So I think that that's a theme that we'll return to in all of the case studies. So I'd like to pass it off to Jose Esperon and Jose Medrano, who are going to tell you a little bit about community gardens and stormwater infrastructure.
First, we're going to talk about community gardens. Community garden is any piece of land that is designed and gardened by a group of people. This can be for either food or other outcomes. The first case of community garden was in 1890. It was in Detroit, and then over certain events over history, like World War I, the Great Depression, and World War II, the government and other organizations started to foster community gardens around the country. The Green Period also was a huge event for this kind of community gardens. Until in 1974, we had the first community garden in New York City. So, how start a community garden? First of all, there needs to be a group of people who are interested in starting this project. Also, there's always has to be a sponsor, someone who supports this or another organization that supports this movement. It's very important also to have to pick a location in terms of proximity and an area that is sufficient for and also there's things like rules and especially committed people in order to make this happen. Why community gardens? Well, there's many benefits that come from community gardens. Some of them are fresh fruits and plants. Also, especially how this environment and taking care of the environment. As I said, it has to be an accessible space and it has to be a public space for people of the community to be able to go there. And gave the visitors both economic improvement and environmental improvement, and this gives a different.
So I'm going to be talking to you about some of the benefits of community gardens, which is kind of a big part of the why. And thus, it's a very exciting thing, right? Community gardens, because we're talking about community design, often community-owned infrastructure that has a variety of municipal, health, historical, cultural, social, economic, and environmental benefits. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is health. And obviously, there are many benefits that come with green space, but in New York City, there's also a lack of fresh and healthy food. So healthy food, quality of life, access to the outdoors, the remediation of air pollutants, these are all things that community gardens provide to a neighborhood that is lacking these services because the city is failing to provide them often. Open space, another huge benefit of community gardens. Also landmarks, right? These are places in the neighborhood that people know. These are, you know, corners of lots where people meet. These are neighborhood-defining characteristics. These are, you know, historical connections to memory and to place. People have growing up in New York City. And you can see here many of the sort of examples of the social programming of community gardens. So often community gardens in New York City are places that are started by, you know, growing up communities of color, and these often include many immigrants from other places, and the community gardens have become sort of a place to preserve culture from their homelands and to continue to practice their indigenous traditions, as well as a variety of other, you know, intercultural, intergenerational sort of programming that happens in community gardens that bridge sort of all these gaps between the variety of people. And sort of a big part of community gardens, you know, is the food production, which is often, you know, why they're started. So this is some examples of food market at Union Square in New York City. And some of the food produced here, as you can see, is not just like your typical food that you might find in New York City grocery store, but often, you know, indigenous or plants that come from places where people grew up and are akin to, you know, the type of food that they like to cook. And as sort of an additional benefit, people can make value-added products from these. So, you know, from the peppers, they can make some hot sauce, they can sell that, they can make additional money, so it's like an economic driver for often communities that don't have as much access to economic opportunity as many places in New York. And then the environmental sort of benefits of community gardening are something that are often, like, very overlooked at the municipal level. And to the city, these are just, you know, places that the community has sort of occupied, but there are, you know, very many benefits that community gardens provide and sort of take over the municipal services aspect of green space. And we have here a whole list, you know, biodiversity, they improve water and sewer quality, which we're going to get into. And so we talked a little bit about community gardens. I want to now talk about the problem and why community gardens are what we think is part of the solution to this problem, which in New York City is stormwater management. So as you can see from this map, vegetation in New York City is particularly sparse in areas, especially dense areas, as Abigail pointed out earlier, in Manhattan. And so if we look here, you know, we see in the lower Manhattan section, which is where our case study is, there's not a whole lot of vegetative surfaces, which means there's not a lot of permeable surfaces to absorb stormwater. And you can see this is just what it looks like, right? It's really built up, really developed, got a whole lot of green space. And this is the area that we're going to be talking about today. So what this means for water quality in New York City, right, is that New York City has a challenged sewer system. And this map here shows the instances of sewer backups throughout the city, basically explaining areas where the sewer is over capacity, where it's causing, you know, infrastructurally challenged, right? It's not meeting capacity of the residents in that area, and there's a host of problems that come with that. What complicates this is that New York City is served by a combined sewer system, which is different than the system that you all have here in Rio. And what a combined sewer system is it's an infrastructure system that uptakes both wastewater and stormwater and combines within the piping below the city. The challenge with this is when there is, you know, a storm or a wet weather event, it can cause the system to overflow and essentially stormwater and wastewater, mixed stormwater and wastewater, get their output into the nearest water body. And the diagram here kind of explains that process and how that happens, which is a major concern for New York City, you know, for the water quality, for the people that live there, and sewers and sanitation is a big part of life. One of the other concerns that sort of the gardens are addressing here are being implemented to address is coastal flooding. So this is actually kind of the response and the reason this the program we'll be talking about got implemented is because of Hurricane Sandy in 2012, which was a catalyst for many programs in New York City. This area here is the Lower East Side where our study area is, and we can see the level of induction is quite intense. Looking at a broader map of the city, we see there are many areas in the city that are vulnerable to storm induction and flooding, coastal flooding.
So here we have a simple diagram of how the typical system is working. We can see that we have two types of two ways to start the system. It can be either storm water or organic waste. The storm water can be treated as waste treatment or it goes straight to the water bodies of the sea. When they go to as waste treatment, they're combined with sewer overflows, just like some we had talked about in the problem. And what this causes is water contamination, so that's why we're addressing this problem, or we're trying to find a way to improve it. So how is this problem being addressed? First of all, the current system is addressing the stormwater problem by new infrastructure and community gardens. Community gardens reduce the water overflow and the stormwater management. And the new infrastructure collects and manages stormwater runoff, streets, sidewalks, parking lots, and other spaces. These are four examples of water capture in community gardens. Their function is always to store water so that it can be used to take on. They have their own, each one has their own different way of operating, but they're just, at the end, they store water for community garden to function. So what is missing? Because we have community gardens and we have green infrastructure, so we analyze the situation and we need to optimize the systems. We have to connect them in order for them to work better.
So the case study we're going to be talking to you about today is an example of where this is happening in New York City. This is the Gardens Rising project in Lower Manhattan. And essentially what this project is, it's a community-driven, community-designed project with funding from the state that connects these green infrastructure ideas that they were just talking about to community gardens in Lower Manhattan. So this project came about through a collaboration of several agencies. The most important sort of agency in this triangle is the New York City Community Gardens Coalition, who sort of got the ball rolling on this. And they're just essentially a coalition of community gardens in New York City. Garden owners throughout the city who own plots and garden, who got together to sort of band together to gain greater like leverage and strength to be able to lobby for assets in the city. And we have the Lower Manhattan Coastal Resilience Plan, which is a result, or sort of response to Hurricane Sandy, and the New York City Environmental Protection Agency, which handles all the environmental issues in New York City. So just to expand on that, this is the timeline of the project. So we had Hurricane Sandy again in 2012. In 2013, we got this New York Rising Community Reconstruction Program, which is a program initiated by New York State to enable communities to sort of build that, right? To build that stronger, to become more resilient, to be able to recover, and sort of bounce forward as well. So in 2015, we got the New York City Community Gardens Coalition applying for a community development block grant, stating that essentially, hey, you know, we have community gardens. We can be a part of the solution. We can get funding. We can implement these things. And so they applied and they got it, right? So since then, we've got a feasibility study and a master plan with Green Design Architects, who's our architecture firm in New York City. And right now, in spring 2017, we're getting to implementation, which is exciting. Just to give you kind of a broad overview of community gardens in New York City, this is where they are generally. the box spot boxes are our study area. So the potential here is great, right? So like we're talking about one small area, the bottom portion of Lower Manhattan. But there are many community gardens in New York City, and you know these gardens are often located in communities of color, low-income communities of color. So the potential here, we think, is for replication is really high. Well, even in Lower Manhattan, these are the case studies of 47 gardens that exist in Lower Manhattan that have become a part of this program, along with some other community gardens in the area who are not part of the program. And again, turning to this idea of storm surge, you know, this is what it is. Many of these gardens are located in some of the floodplains. So, essentially during the feasibility study, what happened was we designed architects went around each individual community garden and designed sort of a strategy for each individual one. But in general, there's some overlap between the interventions that are applicable across all community gardens. And so we have here like a toolkit of the general strategies of how we can better optimize community gardens to absorb stormwater and to sort of solve this combined sewer overflow issue. And I'm not going to go through every single one of these individually, but I'm going to run through the slide and sort of just point out, one by one, ones that are really cool. So, right away, bioswales in this one, pervious behaviors are really great ideas for community gardens. We can see on this one, it's microgrids. So they're trying to be not just think about resiliency as absorbing stormwater, but also how to become just more resilient in general. Different designs for rainwater harvesting, pollinator gardens, soil and compost. Designing structures to allow them to sort of capture rainwater, planting on trees, rain gardens, and then signage to inform people, right? Educate people on what's going on, how they can be part of it. And then indigenous plants, so just planting sustainable gardens, as I said, using sort of plants that are in the area that are going to survive, they're going to best help to remediate the problem, and restoring some sort of wetlands in the area.
So in this section, we can see clearly how community garden operates. We can see some of the toolkits, so say Zolusala, the wetlands, the resource training, and especially some of the important aspects of the community garden and its owners. Another section, we can also see how the rainwater is being treated and some other toolkits and aspects of the community garden in general. So, in the first diagram, we spoke about how the problem is what being addressed. It's been addressed currently, and now in this diagram we see how there's an improved system to address this problem. So stormwater goes through community gardens and new infrastructure, which is what we spoke about, and then this water goes to water bodies and we create a cycle. So this is how we improve the system and how we improve the problem. And organic waste goes directly to waste treatment, so it's something that. So now Rebecca is going to help us to speak about water.
New York is a 10 oyster region. They clean. That is one really important aspect of them. They can clean up to 50 gallons of water a day. They also build. They build giant, strong reefs. That's another important aspect of oysters. Okay, so just to give you a brief history, oysters used to be all along the coast of New York City. They were harvested by the Lenape tribe, which is our indigenous tribe that was along the coast. And then when settlers came, they were really into oysters. They were eating them up along with clams and mussels that also existed. And they practiced a lot of harvesting techniques. And as the city grew and grew, there was more harvesting of oysters. If you've been to New York City before, which many of you raised your hands, you probably know about the popularity of hot dog stands. Oysters used to be the hot dogs in New York City. Kind of gross, but however, due to that, that love for oysters, used as food, but also used as soil fertilizer and as a mortar to build buildings. There was a major over-harvesting of them. Another aspect that happened is there was also large pollution that was being flooded into the New York Harbor. This was happening because people were just dumping their personal waste, their solid waste, their trash into the harbor. But also, you'll see in a moment, there's CFOs. So this gives you a sense in 1905 that the problem was recognized. This is a map of 1905 that shows all of the oyster reefs. And then this also shows over it all of the combined sewage overflow. So that's what Jose Andrade was talking about a moment ago, where there is sewage combining with the waste for the stormwater and going into the harbor. Okay, so now I'm into like the 1970s. Over time, the harbor became more and more polluted. This is a picture from the Bronx. It shows people were dumping cars, tires, refrigerators, ovens into the river. People, there was less investment, and so people felt less invested themselves. This is another image of a similar time. Then in 1972, the U.S. had a sort of a landmark environmental law, the Clean Water Act. Basically, what the Clean Water Act did is it gave the federal government a lot more power over regulating the waterways. Okay, so in New York City, what happened when that was passed, or, you know, a couple decades later, is people remembered the power of the oyster and that New York actually used to have tons of oysters, all of which at this point did not exist, right? So the oyster came clean. And by using that cleaning technique, programs, organizations started to develop that took advantage of it and taught it to their students. So one of these became the New York Harbor School. This was fully established as a school in 2010. And in this picture, they're putting in oysters as well as mussels, which clean as well. Not that we talk about mussels as much, but that's the idea. And they're teaching all sorts of green workforce training, and obviously, you know, biology education to their students. 2012, New York City had Hurricane Sandy, which wreaked widespread havoc across the city. This is one of the images from that time. So as a result of Hurricane Sandy, there was a rebuild by design competition. So it was a competition about how to build more resilient cities. What came out of the rebuild by design competition was actually 100 resilient cities, of which Rio is also one. And then there was a large grant from the from the Department of Housing and Urban Development, HUD, and that's so federal money going into this to create new systems. And what was really important for the oyster in all of this is that this money was then funded into the New York Harbor School and then into the Billion Oyster Project to help with some of those resiliency programs. One of the programs, just to give you some comparison, one of the programs that came out of Rebuild by Design was the Big U Seawall, which has not yet been implemented, but as you can see, it's a large wall network system of parks, as well as different sort of tactics about having these giant seawalls all along New York City's lower section. It is incredibly expensive. It's $335 million US dollars. It is a static structure, meaning that it will not respond to sea level rise, right? It's going to stay where it is. It also is only protecting this one area, and as you can see from that built map, if you remember, this area is fairly rich. There's a lot of money, and that can be the case with seawalls in general. projects cost very little, a couple hundred dollars at most. The process was already underway. As I said before Hurricane Sandy, people were doing that work. And then it also responds to sea level rise. Oysters grow. They're natural, they're organic, and they're going to grow on top of each other no matter what. It's also environmentally just, meaning that it can be easily accessible to all communities. It's easy to build an oyster reef if you have the resources and the people able to do it. But it doesn't harness energy. Okay. This is just another way to say what I just said, which is that they outpace sea level rise and they stop wave power. All right, so talking about the Billion Oyster Project, which again is out of the New York Harbor School. It's funded largely through Rebuild by Design, but it also has a series of other organizations and grants that are working for it, including the New York Harbor Foundation. Some of the tactics that it's using are, again, education, this environmental justice thing, the workforce development, so teaching students a lot of green infrastructure projects and techniques for them to carry on. It's also something that's pretty exciting about it is it's using waste in New York City in an interesting way. One of the examples of this is New York City wanted to turn all of its toilets in its public schools into efficient toilets, and so that meant that it had to dump thousands and thousands of toilets in the landfills. Instead of doing that, they crush them up, clean them out a lot, and put them into the ocean or to the harbor, and make them into reefs. So one of the biggest reef projects happening right now is with these toilets. They're also recycling shells that have been used at restaurants. New Yorkers, regardless of the fact that there weren't oysters in the harbor, eat oysters all of the time, which meant that shells were just being dumped into landfills coming out of restaurants. So instead, they're being recycled. These are some sense of some of the numbers and their successes that they've reached. As you can see here, this is also an image of the fact that they're teaching students how to scuba dive and set oyster reefs themselves and really understand what's happening on the harbor floor. Okay, so some of the issues going forward, I don't know that everyone knows who this is, but this is Ben Carson, who is our recent HUD secretary. Ben Carson is elected by Donald Trump. We don't quite know what his policies are going to be totally as of yet. However, this is more symbolic of the fact that the major problem, which is that for any federal funding going to New York City currently, is at jeopardy with the new administration. And that's true on a number of levels, but largely true right now because Trump has threatened to take away all federal funding from sanctuary cities, so cities that are protecting immigrant populations. So that's a problem. And then secondly, climate change is still going on. Again, just to say for a moment, we currently have a secretary of our environmental department that doesn't believe in climate change, and so that's also an issue. All of these issues that I'm saying too apply to every single case study that we're talking about, but I'm just making it clear in this one. Also, trash pollution is still a prevalent major issue in New York City due to New York City residents, but also all residents upstream from us. And then finally, the Clean Water Act is also at risk. The Trump administration recently has been trying to pull back on a policy that was extended by the Obama administration, which really limits the scope of the Clean Water Act. So that's an issue. All right, well, on that happy note, I'm going to switch it over to Carolyn.
This one too. Hello, everybody. So I want to talk about two case studies that are kind of at different scales and located in different areas in New York. One of them, Stonebrook Center for Food and Agriculture, is actually also in New York City, but it's upstream on the Hudson River in Tarrytown, New York. So it kind of has a little regional scope in terms of sustainable agriculture and environmental remediation. And Woodland Grange is actually located very close to Pratt Institute in a new development. So it's kind of a project that exists hand in hand with a lot of new development and adaptive reuse of former I'm here again just to show you a little bit the location of these. So as we mentioned earlier, a typical system in terms of food distribution and agriculture is not so much of a closed loop, but more linear and more centralized, which poses many problems for the environment. So basically, since colonialists came to the United States and industrialization happened, we have been moving forward at a very, very strong pace, driven by capitalism towards large industrial agriculture. And that poses a threat to the environment and to, in so many ways. So these this rapid growth using heavy machinery, pesticides, heavy use of pesticides, and to stay competitive, farmers have to really grow very, very fast, which led to homogenization of breeding and crops, kind of dictating what the diet in the U.S. nationwide was. And really, really, what's very important is that all of these practices really deteriorated our nation's soils. And in an agricultural system, everything is an ecosystem in itself, and soil is actually a very complex ecosystem composed of micronutrients. And so once you mess with the soil, then everything down the line is going to be affected. So I want to present some projects that are striving for a more closed-loop, sustainable system that you see here. And I'm kind of calling back our group's diagram to show you the areas we're focusing on. So again, agriculture, food distribution, in New York. So the first case study I'm mentioning here is called the Stonebarn Center for Food and Agriculture. And as you can see, this image looks very different from the former images I was showing of large-scale, scary, industrial American farms. It looks like a small house. It looks very much more human scale in a country pastoral landscape. And so basically, this was started by a group of intellectual farmers and chefs and horticulturists and experts kind of in these fields and in sciences who are trying to revolutionize the way the United States is conducting agriculture in the 21st century. And so Dan Barber is actually a very well-known chef. I don't know if you guys get the Chef's Table here on Netflix, but maybe some of you have heard of him because one of the episodes was about him. He seems a little crazy, but I think that comes with being a forward-thinking person and very rigorous intellectual. And so he was really catalyzing personality in this movement, reaching globally for experts, like I said, intellectual experts in food and science, to really rethink the way that we think of a career in food and agriculture needs. It needs to be a farmer in the 21st century. Dan Barber read and discovered that most farmers in the United States today are older than 50 years old. So he really wanted to shake things up, and he brings almost like a tech industry startup mentality to really just doing what he can to involve the brightest minds in these fields together to change the way agriculture is done. So again, just in context to show you, so Stonebarn is definitely located in a much more green rural area along the Hudson River. So some of the projects that Stonebarn are kind of unique for starting are what they have called small and slow tools. So they discovered that it's very difficult to source machinery and tools that are not designed for massive, monstrous, huge farms. So they have started, kind of designing and building their own, and providing the blueprints for other emerging farmers to be able to kind of share this knowledge. So that's also a very interesting thing that they're doing, is that they really want to foster other farmers to adopt the same policies and activities, because as we're seeing in all of our case studies, we all live in an ecosystem and everything is connected and everything is interconnected, so this is part of that. Another thing that Stone Gardens is known for is doing at the moment is reintroducing heritage breeds of animals, because another cause of massive industrial agriculture is that the diversity of breeds really disappeared in the United States. And it's all about packaging. Even single animals are chopped up and packaged, and we never really, so our diets have really been reduced, and we're no longer used to eating a full animal, let alone different breeds of animals. So they're really kind of introducing this new heritage breeds. They are contributing to cross diversification, and so basically, and soil phytoremediation is also very linked to that. As I was saying before, soil is composed of many micronutrients, and so in order to have healthy soil, you have to rotate crops and strategically rotate them so that they become stronger without pesticides, without any type of chemicals, fully organic, and this allows for crops to become more resilient and for more native crops to emerge and be able to withstand in this environment. So they also have a lot of community programs, workshops, CSA, so those are programs that you can, as a resident, a nearby resident to the farm, you can apply, and they will provide you, you pay in advance for a season, and they will provide you with food weekly, fresh organic produce weekly. And again, as you can see, this image really, this beautiful collaboration between chefs and farmers and the community. So basically, Stone Bars is really fostering this idea of a rich ecosystem from their soil to the way that they do business. So my second case study is the Brooklyn Grange Rooftop Farm. It is located on top of one of the large industrial buildings located in the former Brooklyn Navy Yard. So it's that bottom dot on the top. So this is the building, and this is actually quite close to Pratt, and Pratt Institute actually has some space in this, not necessarily in this building, but in this whole complex. And this has been a really interesting project for Brooklyn, like I said, in the reuse of former industrial spaces. This image you may not necessarily see it, but one thing that I wanted to point out is that it is on a rooftop, and unfortunately in New York City, as in Rio, you're competing for space, and so a lot of open spaces and public spaces kind of have to be on rooftops, which is amazing, and I'm all for it. I think all of our roofs should be green. But it does mean that they're not really that easily accessible to the public. So Brooklyn Grange was started by some farmers and botanists and horticulturists that were based in Brooklyn, with a vocation to bring organic produce to the city and really teach New Yorkers about the environment and and bring them closer to their food source and to their food system. So some of the programs that they have going on, other than distribution of organic produce to restaurants and farmers markets, again, also phytoremediation, so they are all organic, they do not use pesticides, they do not use chemicals, and this is kind of out of necessity to be competitive, because they do have to compete, in a business sense, to stay functioning. They have to maximize the use of their space. So they have community workshops, beekeeping apprenticeships. Also, again, kind of trying to get the youth interested again in agriculture and farming and other activities related to food and environmental remediation. And they also open up their space for various events, weddings, yoga classes, and they also operate their own landscape design and build. So basically, to conclude, I did want to point out some of the challenges that are faced by both of these organizations. For Stone Barns on the left, again, because it's so far upstate, for the vast community of New Yorkers that really truly need to be reconnected with their natural environment and with farming and their food system, it's not so accessible. A lot of these practices are inefficient in a business perspective. It's very hard to stay alive. So network expansion can be very difficult. And, it's just a very unpredictable financial situation. And for Brooklyn Grange, a lot of the same things apply. But for them, the main thing is being located in the middle of Brooklyn. You have a lot of space, so you're competing with that. And it also is a project that unfortunately kind of still is located in an area that is mainly accessible to people of higher, moderate to higher income groups. So, it's still a product of gentrification, so it's not a completely equal system yet. And food deserts is a little bit linked to gentrification. So we call those areas in New York, or in big cities in the United States, where high quality organic produce is not found in poor areas. So this is still kind of the trend that Brooklyn Grange is still kind of adhering to. And we are going to go into the waste part of our system next. Thank you so much.
So yes, we have been following this connected web of systems from water to food and what comes next, but waste, right? When you eat an apple, you're left with a core and other things. So we are going to be sharing with you some of the characteristics of the current waste system in New York City. Right now, your waste that you eat is collected by a truck and sent to a landfill, and your waste from your wastewater is processed in a wastewater treatment plant, which has the issues that Jose and Jose discussed with combined sewer overflow. So, if you've been to New York City, probably one of the most surprising things you saw was the amount of trash on our streets. It's really shocking. This is how our solid waste is collected. We spend about 3% of an enormous budget on collecting it. And it's collected by truck in an extremely dense city. These trucks are moving around at all hours of the day, particularly concentrated in a couple of low-income communities of color, which creates a lot of pollution. It's then transferred through a marine transfer station to a garbage barge, a boat, and it ends up in a landfill. So, in order to move all of New York City's solid waste, organic waste, or solid waste in general, to these landfills, it's over 3 million metric tons. We have to not do it in New York City because of the space constraints. We actually send a lot of it to other parts of the country, as far away as other states in Kentucky. So in response to this, a new policy was created a few years ago that the goal is to create zero waste to landfill by 2030. And it is in this context that politicians saw an opportunity. 30% of this waste is actually organic waste, so it could be composted. And so in a more sustainable system we're going to discuss, there's sort of some more of the closed loops. So we'll talk about two techniques for moving this immense amount of organic waste out of landfills and into more sustainable systems. The first is compost, the second is biodigestion, and we're going to be talking about these on two different scales. One is sort of a smaller scale and the other is a municipal scale. So to begin, neighborhood scale composting, we'll be talking about an organization called the Lower East Side Ecology Center. It's located in the Lower East Side, the same neighborhood that Jose was talking about with the community gardens. And it really came out of this history of community gardens as a sort of response to this open land that people claimed and cultivated, and this organization grew out of that history. And they have a site in East River Park, right on the East River, that's owned by the New York City Parks Department. So it's an interesting collaboration. They are a nonprofit organization, but they're permitted to use this public land in exchange for their services of composting and other stewardship services that they provide. And so the way that their composting center works is that, go to the next slide, people drop off their scraps at strategic locations around the Lower East Side, often near subway stations. So on the way to work, you pick up your compost, you drop it in the bin, so it's sort of an easy thing to do. And they think of it as donating it. You're donating your scraps to this organization. Next, it's placed in these white bins for about 2 weeks. It's mixed with sawdust material. And then for the next 2 weeks, it's put into these windrows, and then it's cured for about 3 to 6 weeks. And then the really interesting part of this model is that different community garden groups then come and pick up the compost. So they pick up a cubic meter of compost and take it to their garden and use it. And it's very local in this neighborhood. So sort of reduces the need for a lot of truck traffic around. They just have one truck that they use to do this entire operation.
I'm going to be talking now about a municipal scale. My name is Renee. So as part of the New York City's goal to eliminate waste to landfill by 2030, there's a municipal, like, citywide composting project. The pilot was started in 2013, so they just kind of finished the first pilot and now they're doing an evaluation of it. But essentially, it was a program that provided these brown garbage bins. As you saw, most garbage is in black bags on the sidewalk. Provided these brown garbage bins to residents all around the city and educated them about what's provided in compost bins, and then municipal workers come in compost appropriate trucks, so it's not the same trucks as the garbage trucks, which is important, but comes in and actually picks up the compost directly from your home. So with the pilot, 33,000 households were part of this. This is just a map showing that it wasn't all of the city, and in fact it was nowhere in Manhattan, because Manhattan is so dense that this project with these trucks was actually way too difficult. But in a variety of neighborhoods and outer boroughs, 13 neighborhoods, about 45 metric tons a day of waste was removed from the landfill system. And along with this pilot project to pick up residential compost, there was also an effort to pick up from public schools. So 800 schools participated in this, and they were able to remove even more waste from the system, about 4,800 tons.
So the next technique that we're going to talk about is called anaerobic biodigestion. And I just want to share really quickly that right before I went on this trip, somebody was asking me, we're living in sort of a difficult political time, maybe everywhere, maybe in the United States, certainly in the United States. And somebody says, there's something you're excited about. And I said, anaerobic biodigestion. And she said, what is that? Has anyone heard of this? Anaerobic biodigestion? Okay, some of you haven't. Great. So anaerobic biodigestion is the other sort of thing that we're going to be talking about. And this is a diagram that explains how it works. Organic waste goes into a biodigester. There's no air, that's the anaerobic part. It sort of bacteria digests it and produces two main outputs. One is biogas, which can be used for energy, and the other is, after a process, organic biofertilizer. And if you have trouble remembering that, you can use your hand and just make the I love you symbol in sign language. And in is the inputs, and out are the two outputs, fertilizer and gas. Okay? All useful. So these biodigesters can be made out of lots of different materials. This one's made out of an intermediate bulk container and insulated. This next one's made out of a pickle barrel. So whatever you sort of have around. And we're very lucky to visit one actually that's here in Rio. So we're kind of going off the New York City case studies for just a moment to say that we visited Valle Incompatible this week, and we saw two different biodigesters that were created for that community. This one is based on food waste, and this one is the for sewage waste. And both sort of fill a need for infrastructure, for energy, for wastewater treatment, while also providing a way to dispose of organic waste.
So the anaerobic digesters you just saw fit in people's arms and they can sit on them. This is an anaerobic digester that is 140 feet tall, and it's a municipal scale biodigester. It's actually a waste treatment plant. So this is processing New York City's sewage. Works in a very similar way, except instead of food scraps, it's toilet scraps. That goes through this system and produces, again, compost and biogas. So this is a really interesting project because New York City has many wastewater treatment plants. You know, there's 8.5 million people, there's a lot of sewage, and it's been a constant issue, as we've already talked about many times in this presentation, to manage that wastewater in a way that is not polluting the waterways when there are storms. So this project was designed to take that sewage, process it, but also return turn that waste into resource instead of having to just outsource the sewage post sort of, so the sewage goes into the plant, it's treated, but then at the end of it, there's still all of this solid waste. And for the history of New York City, we've been sending that waste to landfill. So this wastewater treatment plant is trying to end that and close that loop. It's serving 1 million residents, so it's not the entire city. But it's a huge amount of sewage water, and while right now the biogas being produced by this is serving only the wastewater treatment plant, but the goal is that that biogas would be returned to the gas network for the city and would effectively power 530 homes each year. So these four projects obviously differ in terms of the scale and the impact, though the technologies tend to be quite similar. So we just want to talk a little bit about how the scale of these projects are affecting who they serve and how much they cost. So in terms of the compost, about 1 ton a day is collected by the Lower East Side Compost Ecology Center versus about 55 for the municipal scale. 31,000 households are served versus 133,000. And it's interesting because while the scale, you can see the impact of the scale at the municipal level, because it costs about 1,500 million reais, I believe it's million, 1,500 reais per metric ton collected at the municipal scale, but it's three times that much at the smaller scale. So there is an economic advantage to upscaling. In terms of the biodigesters, of course, the Valle Incompatible version project that we showed you is a fairly small project, serving about 5 households, but it costs very little to build, and it's built by the people in the community, and people in the community know how it works, know how to fix it, know how to benefit from it, and it is currently providing cooking gas to one home. Whereas at the municipal scale, we have a huge number of homes that are being served, but it's an incredibly large cost, incredibly large maintenance and operating costs, and currently it's not serving, it's not actually returning any fuel to the city, though the hope is that it ultimately. So our four case studies for the process for Abigail and I going through this really ended up with two very big questions. One is that it's hard to get New Yorkers to participate in the composting project. New Yorkers are used to putting their garbage in a bag and putting it on the sidewalk and not thinking about it anymore. So asking people to separate their waste has been a challenge, and people have responded like, I don't want to have to sift through my garbage and figure out what can go in the composting bins. So that's one issue, is behavior change. And the other issue, particularly with the large scale municipal projects, is how do you move, in particular with the composting, how do you move this waste around the city? How do you get to composting centers without exacerbating the pollution problem? Truck traffic and truck pollution is a huge issue in the city, and as Abigail mentioned, particularly in the neighborhoods where these, they're called waste transfer stations exist, and those tend to be in low-income communities of color. So right now we're just adding truck traffic to the city streets rather than removing truck traffic, because we haven't removed enough organic waste from the system to actually reduce the number of waste trucks. So that's an ongoing question that we have for how the system can evolve in the future. Now we're going to turn it over to Jonathan and Gabby to talk about financing sustainable infrastructure.
Hello everybody, again, I'm Gabby Gabriella, and this is Jonathan. We're going to talk to you guys about infrastructure financing. So a lot of the projects that we just talked about, or any project really in the city, you can't get it done without financing. So how does this happen in the city of New York? We're going to talk about three different ways that it does. One is through government initiated financing. Another one is community-initiated financing, and the last one is only partner-initiated financing.
So what we'll look into, first off, are government-initiated infrastructure projects. They sometimes call it top-down because who dictates it, who runs it, comes from the government down. And the community doesn't necessarily have too much control of what happens. But we're going to talk about how our city government utilize things like tax revenue to fund things like waste management, transportation, and two types of green infrastructure. So first, we're going to cycle back to the Newtown Creek Wastewater Treatment Plant, in which the Department of Environmental Protection was involved in gathering tax revenue from people to fund the construction of this particular development. They, of course, hired three private architecture firms to go ahead and build it. That's how the funding system worked. Now, this particular case study, Hudson Yards, is a bit different in terms of its funding mechanism. So they use something called tax increment financing, which I'll explain in the next slide. But basically, there were three main agencies involved: the Metropolitan Transit Authority, Port Authority of New York and New Jersey, and New York City Environmental Development Corporation. And basically, they pooled together resources to build a new development that would be like office space and housing. You're wondering about this site? I don't know if you know, New York City was also a candidate for the Olympics in 2012, and so our mayor at the time, since we lost the bid to London, they decided, all right, well, let's put some housing and office space here. So how this particular tax increment financing system works: you have a tax district, just an area in which, of course, property taxes are collected, but then, of course, with development going in, property taxes will increase. And so what they do, they take the increase of property taxes, use that increase to fund the project. Now, this particular project, they said, oh yeah, it'll be great for the city because it'll add office space, it'll increase jobs, it'll give revenue to the Metropolitan Transit Authority for more infrastructure projects. But there are also some downsides. They say the main pluses or advantages is that it pays for itself. It's, but at the same time, it's kind of negative because it's depending on an increase in property values. Now, of course, when property values go up, it has all kinds of effects, you know, to neighbors around you. Also, they say it'll be a revenue generator and it'll increase the amount of housing. However, it does nothing to address the affordable housing situation in the United States.
So next, we're going to be talking about exciting grants, which, of course, you probably guys know, is just simply the government giving you money once you put in an application. So what we're typically talking about is NYC Green Infrastructure Grant. Now, this grant is one of the many different ways that the Brooklyn Grange was funded and started. So the grant obviously gets money from tax revenue from people, and that tax revenue goes to the NYC Department of Environmental Protection, which hands out those grants. And then the grants, of course, goes to these large projects here. So some pluses and minuses is that this grant, for particularly the Brooklyn Grange groups, which you guys know a little bit about it now, is that traditional groups last a lot longer than other groups. So if a large corporation goes ahead and decides to invest in this, this would be a really good investment. You don't have to spend any more money on it. However, there's negatives, such as the fact that green groups can be really expensive. So the Grange, it costs about $500,000. That's the size of the grant. It was actually one in 15 different grants that that New York City gave out for this particular program. And additionally, this first grant was also given out about 2010. So this is a fairly recent program too. But yeah, these groups can be really expensive, and there's a lot of upkeep that comes with it. So a grant, one-time grant, isn't necessary to cover it. So next, on a smaller scale, we have the NYC Green Roof Tax Abatement. This is a little bit different. Instead of the home property owners who have a green roof or like to build a green roof, they go ahead and put an application to the mayor's office of sustainability and other related offices such as taxes and buildings, so that way they can get approved for this tax abatement. Of course, this tax abatement is a one-time thing, and it is for smaller properties. So that's the positive thing. It is for smaller properties. You don't have to be a big building like the Brooklyn Naval Yard. You can be your own house and have your own green room to apply for this. However, the tax abatement is only $4.50 per square foot, or up to $100,000. So sometimes that's just not enough incentive for enough people to go ahead and install these green rooms. So next, we're going to talk about the NYC Solar Partnership. So this is quite complex, as you can see from this diagram, but I promise it's really cool and great way to get solar panels onto people's houses and get solar energy throughout the community. So first, there's the property owners, which we post in this particular diagram, that their past solar panels are interested in investing in solar panels. And what happens is that with the energy that is created by the solar panels is sent to utilities and created into utility credits for the community members. So the people that would be involved in this, in getting solar energy from the panels, they can go ahead and pay into a share and pay it towards the solar project owners. So the solar project owners are basically the developers that can build and install the solar panels into your home, or can help run the solar energy program, distributing the solar energy and whatnot throughout the community. And that, of course, goes back in and creates a whole entire loop with the solar project owners paying the lease to the property owners. And additionally, the New York government, the NYC, gives you a tax abatement if you decide to go ahead and put a solar panel on your house, just like the previous green roof tax abatement. And they also help you find developers. So if you have no idea where to start, they give you a list of certified developers to, you know, get the project started. So this is just a simple breakdown of how the subscription for your community member and you're interested in. you can go ahead and you know, be a part of this monitoring system. So first the solar panels are installed, and then anyone that's in the surrounding neighborhood, they can go ahead and subscribe, and that goes towards your bills. The credits being on the solar panel system is credited towards your bills. So plus and minuses, pros and cons of this particular program is that one of the positive is that it encourages the green economy. Like I mentioned before, the government really does try to invest into green developers, solar panel developers, so they get a lot of the business that they need to get started and make things cheaper. But a negative is that tax owners only receive tax abatements, and it's not really suitable for everyone, so there might not be an incentive for this to be a natural commission. So next we're going to talk about current initiative structure. So this goes with, it starts with grantors that give money to organizations, and then organizations in turn put it into the infrastructure. So it's taking government out of decision organizations.
So there are three examples we'll look at. Say the Billion Oyster Project, in which see funding from the United States Department of Housing and Urban Development and the Rockefeller Foundation to fund their efforts and their collaborations with the New York Harbor School. And also Gardens Rising, in which New York Rising from the state level helped with New York City Community Gardens Coalitions and a community-based organization called Lungs to really get the process going and the funding required for their community gardens. Also, there's Stone Barns, Center for Food and Agriculture, which utilized funding from the United States Department of Agriculture, the Rockefeller Foundation, and also a series of restaurants that actually Dan Barber owns, called Blue Hill Markets as well. They are also sources of revenue, as well as, most importantly, individual business. So now we will look at just community-initiated infrastructure, basically ones that you can do when the government bids. So people utilizing their resources and their power to get organizations to have an infrastructure. So one example is East New York Farms, where they basically, sure, they received a small grant from the state, but they're mostly funded through donations. And they're able to have farms and certain programming that get youth engaged in agriculture in the middle of the city.
So next we have Here Comes Solar, which is really similar to the previous program that I talked about. Where you have kind of a subscribership within a community onto solar panels. So first it starts with the nonprofit organization Here Comes Solar. And what they do is that they help a community or a group of maybe 3 to 10 homeowners or individual homeowners find the funding within their community, contractors, of course, other people that want to join in, they kind of advertise to the rest of your community if you're struggling to find those other 2 or 3 or maybe 10 to be involved in the process. And then finally, they install the solar panels. So plus and minuses of this particular program is that one of the positives, obviously, is cleaner energy. It's cheaper energy for a lot of consumers. But the negative is that this is really dependent on the income of the neighborhood. So Here Comes Solar does help you try to find grants and tax abatements and different things, but some of the richer neighborhoods that we pointed out earlier in the presentation might be the only ones that can really take advantage of this program.
So my partner talked about two different styles of ownership. One where you own shares of solar infrastructure, and another where you actually own the infrastructure itself as a group, and you're able to purchase it. Now, you need an organization to be able to do that, and one such example is something that you actually have already called the cooperative. So this case study I'll talk about just a little bit is probably the most well-known one we have in New York City, the Park Slope Food Cooperative. Basically, they utilize purchases, membership fees, and actually sweat equity. Like people who get down and dirty and do the work, donate their time to be able to take care of the operational costs of Park Slope Food Cooperative. Now, as you can kind of see, the membership fee is kind of high. It's $125 US, and they actually gain, on average, about $3,000 from each of their members through their purchases and their membership fees and any sort of time that they give. And their sort of net income, let's say 2013, is just a little over $220,000. Also, what I guess is sort of a plus is that the startup cost is $1 million US. Depends on your ability to do that. So, positives and negatives. Positives, of course, is that they bring healthy food to a neighborhood that needs it or needs to need it. But a major negative is that it's kind of stratified. Like, you know, people now that live in Park Slope now are kind of more towards the affluent side, or tend to be more towards the affluent side. So, in terms of who can really participate, there's a bit of an issue. However, they do offer reduced rates for people on benefits, like who receive help from the government. So that's certainly a plus that they report. Another example I'd like to talk about a little bit is something called IOPI. Now, quick question: who here has heard of something called crowdfunding? Raise your hand. So the main difference between IOPI, something like crowdfunding, is that they actually, number one, they provide training to people who submit project ideas and such for how to further advertise their initiatives and basically get the word out. And also, they bring in volunteers, which is, you know, one of the things we need. You need people on the ground willing to do the work that you want to do. So IOPI kind of connects all of them together. And here, as you kind of see, funds and ideas go on their web platform, because this is online, just like a crowdfunding site. In return, they give you training. And the funds and manpower go to certain infrastructure projects. In return, they talk about IOPI, they give you publicity, and they allow them to do more work. Of course, it connects online donors and project volunteers into the process, so that just basically creates a system and a process where a project can go from start to finish, ideation to completion, all within the community's power, the community's control. So the positive, of course, crowd resourcing. You don't have to depend on the government to get things done. Also, it's online, so it promotes your stuff, and it can be used to promote your stuff no matter where you are, because it's online. I guess the negative, sort of a negative, is that projects are kind of small, tend to be sort of small. Average donations are $30 US, average projects are about $4,000 if they ask for. So they're really small projects. However, there have been over 1,000 of these incorporated throughout the nation, not just in New York City. So it's something that is sort of flexible and can be utilized anywhere. So the question is something like this possibly in the future, what could we use here in the field? Well, no one has to try.
All right, so that is it for our presentation. So thank you, obrigada. I hope you guys enjoyed your overall presentation. Yeah, so we're gonna have everybody come up here for questions. And basically, of course, questions, comments, but we do wanna start off the conversation kind of comparing the different models that we had in New York City and look at it and maybe not exactly a Rio context, but what's going on here in Rio and kind of
meld those two together, see what we can take from each other as far as solutions and problems. So, yeah, Ryan, have a great day here.
Like, not only you know, how they went about things, but, you know, what they thought was important, what they prioritized. So a lot of it depends on just kind of what the government prioritizes. But in the case that they don't quite prioritize the best things, it's up to you.
So I'm going to talk about just like briefly the community gardens and like how this, like your question is being handled by community gardeners. So New York City, and this is like a lot we talk about in Rio, is just like how the labor processes, like the motivation of the government, right? And in New York City, the government is motivated by collecting tax money, because that's how they function. Whether you're a neoliberal city, they want the most tax money for land values that they can collect. So what that means for community gardeners, it means that they have to be able to speak to the government in language that they can understand. So they have to be able to say, hey, you know, we're providing these municipal services that you should be providing. It costs us very little to provide these services. It would cost you a lot of money to provide these services. And therefore, we're actually, you know, we're doing you a favor, right? We're doing you a solid. So that's like, that's one of the big ways that we sort of have gathered and sort of, you know, apply technical abilities to help community gardeners to show that our land valuation and, you know, municipal services that gardeners are providing are actually a benefit to city, because they're saving the city money. And they're doing it much more like efficiently than the city could do it if they were to come in with a big infrastructure project.
I will say though that an issue with that process can be that the city thinks that the community is doing it themselves and so they don't need to do anything. That's happened, there were like oil spills in one of the rivers in the Bronx, and community residents came out and cleaned it up and like worked together, and so the government thought they didn't have to do anything. And that can be part of the issue. However, to speak to what Jay was just saying, and what we've seen a lot in favelas as we've been here is the importance on sort of describing things as an asset and how the community actually provides a huge asset and just doing things as best as you can with the resources you can until they're really seen as an asset. And then making sure that, you know, your intentions in creating them are actually upheld by the government rather than being twisted into something that the community doesn't professional want.
Aqui no Rio já é um peso muito grande. Eu posso afirmar que o governo carioca brasileiro, ele tem muita. Eu posso afirmar que ele tem medo de não desenvolver nem tratar o povo americano bem. Ainda mais quando está por uma iniciativa no Rio ou em qualquer cidade do país. A pergunta é: qual a possibilidade de você deixar um legado visitando, apoiando, acompanhando por meio do meio de direitos sociais? Para estar engajado nos projetos que já existem em desenvolvimento aqui no Rio.
So Leonel said that in the 1970s there was this opportunity
on the Lower East Side, there was vacant land, people occupied it, and they cultivated things. They didn't ask permission, but that was because the situation was one of the government neglecting the poor neighborhoods. Now, if you try to occupy a vacant land, piece of vacant land on the Lower East Side, you will be immediately kicked out. That's not a strategic move to do now in New York. I think that there are some opportunities if you read the situation here, and I, again, I'm not an expert at all, you are, on what the strategy should be. I think there is a big role for people in other countries, in the international community, the media, institutions, academics, non-government organizations, to step in and act strategically where the government is clearly failing, in my view. So I think we're looking forward to doing that. That's been one of the sort of privileges of getting to be here and see your work.
That point, and then you can follow up. John, connect that point and you follow up.
Yeah. I also think that some of what we saw this week had a lot to do with narrative. And like that Carlos brought up, that there's this narrative that in the US, everything is super developed, everything is great, we are here to be revered, we came here so we have to be treated well, because we've done better, we've already progressed beyond what's going on here. That's not true. But in this case, the narrative really helps. So even though that's not true, even though we do have our problems there, these projects aside, we can leverage that to create some sort of pressure and put some outside pressure on a government that thinks that we're more important than we really think we are, and we really are. I think that Carlos is right. And we do hope to do something beyond, as Prentice, to, with the help of Fidesa, who's done a great job of leveraging this international pressure in the past, to do more than just share ideas, but to actually share projects and begin to build upon this by leveraging this opportunity. John.
Yeah, I also wanted to bring up, I mean, there is a little bit of danger, let's say, if you include something like International Monetary Fund or World Bank, things of that nature. There could be a bit of a problematic relationship set with that in terms of development and such, and being able to pay back those loans, for example. But something to keep in mind, I mean, in terms of our development, like, it took quite some time to get there. And how, you know, countries are developing nowadays, like those that are less developed than we are, because really there are, it's very different in certain areas of the US than other areas. It's happening at a much faster pace. And so a great thing about, you know, you guys doing it now is that you're able to learn from the mistakes that we made, because how we went about it, certainly not perfect. We made a lot of stumbles along the way in terms of our development. And so, you know, it's a great thing, you know, the things that people like you were doing. But also, I guess, as Abigail was saying, one role that we could play is really promoting what you guys do. And even if, you know, people on our side, you know, in the US, for example, are able to get into, let's say, organizations that can provide funding, for example, really change sort of paradigm, or like the sort of process of how things are done, how projects are funded, to really place a lot more of the control in your hands, and not necessarily in the hands of things like International Monetary Fund or the World Bank.
Just briefly, I was thinking with Abigail's comment about strategy, I also think your question is really brilliant, and from being here, I've just been thinking about just feeling amazed by the work that's going on here, feeling very jealous in some ways of the incredible community engagement that I'm seeing on some of these projects, and trying to figure out what is the support that, you know, we're students, but we have networks potentially, what would be the most useful support? Is it pressure on the state? Is it lessons about, you know, what's done with what's worked well and what has? Is it money? Is it collaboration with similar projects in the United States, creating like sister or brother partnerships and across the continent. So I think the question, not to throw it back at you, we can continue this conversation later, but what are the things that would be most helpful for your organization and for others that people in the United States who are passionate about the work you're doing and who are trying to do similar work in a different context, what really that partnership would look like?
Justamente isso aí que você falou agora seria muito importante, divulgar o trabalho e poder ser um levantador da bandeira do trabalho que a gente já desenvolve aqui. Com certeza, muitas pessoas estariam também em outras instituições que querem investir, mas não sabem o caminho. Né? Eu acho que isso aí, com certeza, seria muito importante. Até voltando um pouco atrás, como falou que também a dificuldade de ocupações, eu já venho realmente de todo esse canal. A nossa instituição é um prédio abandonado que o governo largou de mão, então tinha virado na Cracolândia, em frente ao lixão. Então nós fizemos um campo onde era um lixão, pintamos o prédio, desenvolvemos que hoje é o Museu do Grafite, a gente trabalha com o projeto Verde Mar, que é o que a gente faz para o seletivo, ganhamos prêmio, mas a prefeitura, a gestão passada. Só que, como falou, depende muito do governo. E o campo ainda não colocaram tela, o mais difícil foi conseguir quase 200 caminhões de aterro no campo. E o governo não colocou a tela. Então a gente aqui trabalha muito paralelo. A grande verdade, acho que não vou estar falando demais, mas todo sabe que o governo do Rio de Janeiro é muito difícil de apoiar as iniciativas. Por isso que até as ocupações, elas são feitas e depois que ele vem apoia. Eu já vi assim, agora que estamos começando a ter um apoio que estão vendo, e poxa, a gente tem que fazer aquilo ali. Mas eu só digo mesmo de vocês visitarem, estarem perto, isso aí da mídia, da Universidade Americana, visitou o projeto em tal lugar. Então isso é importante. Isso estampa jornais, estampa pessoas interessadas. Isso é muito importante, e a divulgação de vocês também. Tá? Isso aí já ajuda bastante.
I wasn't clear earlier about what we've done during this week, and it's come up a couple of times. I wanted to thank Carlos and Mauricio's in the audience and a few other people. We've been to 6 different favelas. We held a different symposium where people explained to us, including Carlos, what the infrastructure situation and different projects are here in Rio, over at Valle Encantado. And I just want to take a moment to thank them because we kind of skipped over that a little bit, but it's really crucial. It was really crucial for the presentations, but also moving forward for us to glean some of that context and really see it in action to be able to open up this dialogue. And thanks, Carlos, for coming today, and Mauricio and others.
Dois anos atrás, uma das coisas que mais me marcou foi que eles apresentaram essas iniciativas e eles falaram que eles estavam apresentando mais a resistência, os movimentos que criaram várias iniciativas interessantes em Nova York. E todas elas demoraram décadas, eram projetos de décadas, né? Eles explicaram quanto as pessoas tinham que lutar para conseguir o que hoje parece tudo organizadinho às vezes, mas é por causa de muita luta. O Daniel falou, né? 40, 50 anos atrás as pessoas ocuparam terrenos que hoje são esses jardins que a cidade reconhece como um ativo, uma qualidade, uma parte integral da cidade, né? E que eu só ia colocar para eles, talvez eles possam colocar um pouco mais essa profundidade nesses projetos aqui, para a gente entender um pouquinho a história por trás de cada iniciativa.
Like, for example,
other people jump in. Something that comes to mind just is the community garden movement. We're turning to this again, but there was a policy in place in the middle of the 20th century that really was about many of the same issues that we witnessed in the favelas, is about removing poor people and replacing their homes. And that policy urban renewal didn't really work, and it left a lot of holes in the landscape in cities. And in those holes, people organized and started, throwing bombs of seeds over fences, and they would grow up, and then they would take down the fence slowly, and then they would put in some seeds, and then they would put in a composter, and over years and years and years, they created a beautiful garden where before it was just a vacant lot. Nothing was happening there. And it was only then, through that process of sort of informal organizing that took not 1 year, not two seasons, but really decades, that these gardens were able to become formalized. So now they are parklands. So they're protected and they can be evicted. Even if there is a huge housing crisis on the Lower East Side and people are being harassed out of their homes in many of the same ways that we witnessed here in Rio, those gardens are permanent forever. And it's a huge sort of symbol, and it goes right into the deepest soul of the neighborhood, I think. If you walk around there, this characteristic of these gardens, it's like, I'm in the Lower East Side, I see gardens everywhere. And it's really transformed through this collective process. But yeah, it's not like an overnight thing, and I just also wanted to say that we didn't show an example of a biodigester in New York City, because there are no biodigesters in New York City. We looked, we asked everyone, and they just don't exist. So you have something here that is like a seed of that little movement that's happening in Ayungu and other places that we don't have yet. So we want to come back and see how that is going in a few years. And we want to start some in New York too.
So also in, as partially alluded to, in 1933, there was a policy called, quote, redlining, which basically determined areas of the city that would receive investment and other areas that would not receive investment. In fact, disinvestment would happen. Like, resources would be taken away, like, services would be taken away, because as it was coming out of, a sort of difficult time financially. City was coming out of a difficult financial time. And so what happened in response to a lot of this removal of services, you had organizations formed, like tenant associations, many community-based groups, block associations, things of that nature, that would provide services that the city would provide, either because they didn't have the resources or they weren't willing to give those, allocate those resources to serve in those communities. So we had a very sort of organic sort of process of dealing with a government that was not cooperative as well in New York City and throughout the United States.
I also, in response to what Carlos was saying, talking about, and also his work at being a community leader, advocating for waste management, and also just kind of keeping this thread of community gardens. I lived in a very multi-ethnic neighborhood, and there is a huge trash issue actually everywhere in the street. And it really marked me when I moved there, because trash is not handled in the same way in affluent neighborhoods than it is in underdeveloped neighborhoods. And Brooklyn is experiencing a really huge surge in rent prices, like I talked about before, gentrification. So you have developers coming in and building high rises, just like here in Rio and so many places, but they're not addressing the real needs of the communities who, spend their summers sitting out in front of their homes, and enjoying, the bustling street life, but there's trash everywhere, and there may be all these new, high-rise apartments that they can't afford. And so, we have a lot of similar issues, and I did see a community garden crop up, and I was so excited. They cleaned the
vacant lot, and they planted a bunch of seeds. They, it was beautiful wood planters and trails, and it was really inspiring. But you know, I saw a cycle, a year cycle through, and you know, neglect kind of happened, and the garden kind of just disintegrated, and that wasn't really like cared for. So you know, it's a give and take. It's a step forward and a step back. And you know, I think that what I've learned so much here, visiting the favelas, is like the importance of local government. And that's what we have, why we have a crisis in the United States, because people are no longer connected to their local government. Some people are, thankfully, but I really think that that is one of the keys in moving forward in the 21st century. We need to, as citizens, gain power, and I am so inspired by your work for you know, trash awareness and just changing the the way we think about trash, because it's not just something that you know that should be forgotten or that has no value. You know, it actually has a lot of value. It's part of our cycle, it's part of our world, and it doesn't just disappear with us. So all these things, just going back to local government and never giving up, and just you know, we have the same issues.
And they started putting in kelp because they wanted to teach their kids about it. And so then they brought Craft in the Boat does is they teach kids how to build boats, and they teach kids about how to engage in New York City being a true water network. And so they started this whole process. So once they got the money from Rebuild by Design, which was this one project called Hunts Point Lifelines, Hunts Point being this one neighborhood in the Bronx, it made sense to give that money to these oyster beds that were already underway. So this process was already happening and had already started by the community. It was then just given in a similar way to what we've been describing, like given more support by the government, because they could see that it would go somewhere.
I guess just one quick thing, I guess, from the financing side and maybe just kind of from the economic side, like what you had just mentioned, that the government has to see value. And we saw a lot of the things that we look at, particularly the state of idle fat, a lot of them were tax abatements. They're all kind of related to the property in some way. The government has to evaluate your property and deem that the property that you have is worthy of them either, you know, giving you money or not taking back money. And I think that's partially because New York has, I mean, anybody can kind of group on this, or, you know, talk about it more, is that New York City has a very long history of land being very, very valuable. So going back to what Jonathan said, with redlining, and even further back when we're talking about zoning, it's all in a very economic sense. So I guess that was just all to say that as far as like history goes and with New York City, and we haven't learned too much about exactly Rio, but it's all about how much your land costs. What's the price on it, and then from there, you can kind of, it feels like that's when you finally kind of get, you know, started, so, you know, snowballing into, you know, these big organizations and projects that we're looking at.
And just to add on to that too, part of the issue that we haven't quite talked about yet is with the next step being the gentrification step, right? So that by investing in your community, you're also then inviting people to come in and potentially gentrify. I just want to put that on the table.
Hello.
Hi.
So, first of all, thank you so much for the presentations. It was really wonderful to see you. Congratulations. I just wanted to stress and help with the question that there was around government support, but you already gave such great answers, so there's very little to add, I think. I think you always have to look at both sides, which is something that you're stressing as well. Start local, and also if you'd like to help some of the projects here in Rio, I think really it has to come from local initiatives. If you don't have that, it's very hard to develop it any further. So sometimes there is some government support and you have to take advantage of that, such as the 100 Brazilian Cities project of Rockefeller, which Rio did participate in, and there exists a strategy of Rio, which is accessible both in Portuguese and in English. However, I think the biggest fruit of this type of work is actually not in in having that government support, but having engaged the people in writing and developing that. And there are those projects, both within the government and also within the current government, even though we have a difficult local government at the moment, maybe for this type of projects. The technical people do stay within the governments, so they will be there still, even under new new flagships or yeah, it's true. On a technical level, these people are still there, and on a community level as well. So if you look at that type of level, it's usually you find any project. So and then the last thing, just some small remarks on your garden project. There is one in here next to the Arcos. It's horrible how it looks at the moment. Every single day, a group of 50 homeless people lines up to receive food next to an unsuccessful, so far, garden project on a piece of land that's not being used. So if you want to do something, I would say go look there, because I'm sure that the people who started it had the best intentions, and they will be happy to receive your support. On the project with garbage, have you thought about using bikes? to collect the organic waste, and also you would be surprised how much people like to pay to get their organic waste being picked up. This is actually a business model. So you can start a company and charge to pick up people's waste. So if you are successful in that, you will be successful in reducing the amounts of trucks as well that rotate through the city. Specifically, maybe in the richer neighborhoods, people will be aware of this already. It's just like it. And the last thing about using gas in the grids, it's possible as well. In the Netherlands, it happens already. If you cannot make it happen by feeding it back into the grid, which obviously requires some, qualifications for the gas, you could think about like storing gas in zones which are used in kitchens. I don't know if it's being used in Europe, but this could be a solution as well. I hope it helps, and good luck on your presence.
Hi everyone, it's nice to see you again. Thank you so much for your presentation. Very much appreciated it. I hope you also enjoyed the visit in Rossignol. I actually came with the members of Favela Verde, and I could see some of the elements that we discussed in your presentation. So it's very, very nice to see and very much appreciated. Thank you very much. I also, just as a side comment, I loved a lot of the example about the Hudson River, because we did actually pick up fridges in La Boreo, and I don't know if it's still there, but in Valle Encantado they used to have quite a lot of cars. My question is actually much more of a wrapping up summary question. So you gave a lot of really interesting case studies, and I think that from a real perspective, some of them were inspirational, some of them a bit closer to home, some of them a bit further than the reality we have here. So I'm just going to ask you to, if you have all these case studies in mind, and then you can extract the difference of climate, so you add a lot of sun to it, and quite like 20, maybe 40 degrees on average. If you then think about your case studies in a very different fiscal context, so governments not being able to get taxes from as many people in the same way, as regularly, as automatically as they would in the US. If you then again think about all your case studies with a different reality in terms of property and property ownership and property rights, you add to that the current, let's say, government with all its issues, and then the reality and the social reality of the city and the country. I would very much like to hear the kind of top lessons learned from New York to Rio, and the key elements that you think from that could be the most replicable.
Thank you.
That was a long question, right?
No, that was a tough question.
That's sharp, very clever.
I think that's a whole, that's the rest of the collaboration for the next couple of decades, but okay.
Well, I'm going to say just off the bat, and of course John can talk more on this, but we really tried to look into crowdsourcing. Like, we tried to look at different, you know, other ways, other funds, as far as that goes. Off the top of our heads, and Nick is what John was talking about earlier, thinking about other international funds, but as far as, like, just taking a lot of these different projects and looking at the funding and learning about what we learned here, where it's very community-based and consistent in German, would be crowd resourcing, sweat equity, like really working with those smaller neighborhood associations and whatnot, and really coming together. And then also, and that's a really powerful thing. I mean, we're in a very globalized world right now, so I believe it's been mentioned multiple times. I can't pinpoint a particular time on one of our organizations, but they talked about how there's a lot of organization other people through social media. So really using those social media tools as more than just, you know, connecting with friends and the occasional hi or bye, like this is going on in my life. Obviously, you know, social media can be used for a revolution, as we've been seeing for the past like 10 years, and God knows how many different examples. So I would say that from our financing side, that would be kind of our answer. That was your question.
Yeah, and to tie into that, I mean, I would say, stay persistent, stay organized. Those are the key things, of course, because I mean, back to the history, 1929, like, you know, it's the sort of thing like 1929, we had the Great Depression in the US, 1975, we had the New York City financial crisis. Each of those times, there were certain responses that people, like citizens who lived in New York City, took to address the issues that came up with that. And a lot of that became successful. A lot of their efforts became successful because they stayed organized and they were persistent.
Just for me, things that were coming up when I was with you guys at WWG, and I know you already have like an incredible website, and there's like donation on there, and it's like really, I was really impressed, you know, before coming by your kind of marketing skills and the videos and everything. One of the things that was coming up to me also with meeting with Marcelo and like Isabella is like really like the children and involving them, because they haven't yet been completely, you know, like brainwashed, and you know, you can lead by example, and like, you know, they're so incredible. So I don't know, just, you know, keeping them curious and involved, and like passing along all the information to them, and leadership, and giving teaching them early on that they have power, and you know that they are strong and can do anything and make their dreams come true no matter what. Also, just, you know, again, like we were saying, what's exciting about places like Brazil is that you can really skip kind of steps in the way. So I just feel like there's a real need for solar and renewable energies. Like I want to see it everywhere. You know, I know there's like not enough space and people are doing barbecues like on every rooftop, but hey, like you just gotta like just take one, just have one, you know, thing, and then like plug it in, and like I don't know, I just see that as really being an interesting step forward. And I don't know if that's like a way to involve international organizations.
Just one quick thing, and you can also definitely use that towards helping other source of financing. So, I mean, taking a lot of these green energies and then, you know, the green economy and using that money to fund towards other things. I mean, it's, there's a lot of things that goes into it that obviously started up, so that's always a question of, you know, we always have to talk about. But I think that's another thing, like looking at whatever what you already have and using that business model of kind of funding it.
I'm going to intervene, and using what you already have goes back to using the community assets, but leveraging and working with the current projects, as you're saying, as we saw in the places we visited. Because if you just try and implement something, no matter how much top-down, bottom-up you try to make it, if it doesn't start from the community doesn't at least understand a certain need or diagnose a certain potential, and it's not going to happen. If you don't have somebody like Mauricio that comes from the community, that works with art to establish a fight and to battle for certain rights and for certain services, that publicizes it and puts it out to the world. If you don't have somebody like Carlos who puts in bootstraps every day and works in various different fields in culture and art and race and goes to all different kinds of lectures and meets different people to gather them and bring them into his network and improve his own knowledge of things and make. Thank you. make things work, if you don't have those people in the community, it's not going to work.
Yeah, just to build upon that, I think in your question you have part of your answer, which is it's very complicated to do all of those translations. And it might be easier and more freeing to just look in front of you and see what is there and what is your context and pay close, very, very close attention to what is already happening. Because it's not like this is day one of people building communities in favelas. This is, has been 120 years and really all of human history. So I would say be careful of replication as sort of your goal, but rather try to make something that is uniquely rooted here.
Just one last idea, and that hasn't really come up yet and this week, but I'm curious to know more maybe about what's going on here with microfinancing, and kind of, I know those initiatives have been very successful in other countries, India, for example, but, you know, that could be an idea. It doesn't have to be, you know, through banks, but maybe through just the communities, you know, maybe you invest one reais, you know, every month, and that builds up, you know, I don't know, just out of throwing it on top of my head, I'm not at all an expert.
If there's one more question, anybody has one more question? If not, we can wrap up.
Vou encerrar com uma pergunta, não sei se de repente alguém aqui também está junto com ele. Como pode ter um investimento financeiro de 100%, uma empresa pode investir 100% em filme, pode ser descontado no imposto dela 100% em filme, e no meio ambiente não pode ser descontado esses mesmos 100% você desenvolvendo um trabalho ambiental? Parece que o governo entende que se investir 100% de uma empresa no meio ambiente, uma coisa vai ficar para os nossos filhos futuramente, vai resolver o problema, não vai existir pedidos de políticas para poder se resolver. Entendeu? Um filme não resolve o problema da humanidade, mas o desenvolvimento de um trabalho desenvolve. Existe investimento de 100% para filme, mas não existe investimento de 100% para projetos do meio ambiente. Ou se tem, eu não sei.
I want to start the response to that, maybe while you're translating over there. I think part of that is showing and actually creating metrics and actual numbers of some sort to show the value of what the project is doing, to show the environmental value. That's something we didn't talk a lot about here, we didn't have a lot of time to really research this time around, but it's something that actually allowed a lot of these projects to actually take hold in New York City. I might have a lot of bad things to say about the previous mayor, Bloomberg, in New York City, but one thing that they did put in place, a lot of these projects were facilitated by, was their overall sustainable goals for the city, which were based on creating metrics for each kind of system and creating values for each kind of part of the flow of the system. So for solid waste, for solar energy, for how much a tree could improve the air quality and how much money that would save in health costs. That kind of work is in its early stages around the world, but it can really begin to pinpoint and push forward a lot of these initiatives, because then you're talking about money again, even if it isn't money. You're trying to equate that same value, right? If you create a market for it. You don't have necessarily have to have a market, you don't have to have carbon trading or anything like that, but you show the value more clearly to others. I think that's something that needs to happen a lot more going forward to really push this movement forward.
Yeah, I guess it's mostly of what she said, but yeah, basically kind of showing the government, like, hey, if these many kids get sick from this, you know, this environment where it's not being taken care of, look at like all the money that when you're losing, I guess in the future, when these children might potentially be doctors, lawyers, you know, there's so many things that these children have potential for, putting a price on it and saying, hey, you're losing this much money when you don't come in and invest this money. So you're losing this much money have to do invest this much money. And that's basically what you're saying, kind of, that environment and environmental economics that sometimes does have kind of a negative rap for putting such a price on something that shouldn't have a price on it, like a human life or like a tree that obviously provides so much more, but that's the only way that people seem to notice things. But
So para ajudar na tradução de culturalmente, eu acho que aqui no Brasil sempre existiu esse sentimento que temos recursos naturais sem limite. Então temos que apreciar que isso está se mudando agora no Brasil, que já foi reconhecido muito mais antes em outras partes do mundo. Então é porque temos muitos recursos naturais. Então é o momento que estamos passando, vai passar. Não fica desesperada, por favor. Vai passar isso, entendeu? Então é o momento e a luta que houve no Brasil aqui, nos anos 60, 70, 80, para cultura, música, etc, etc, já foi feito. Então, por essa razão temos esse legado, com tantos fundos, acesso a tantos fundos para esses fins, mas vai ter também para os outros fins que têm impacto ambiental e social. Então, até então, acho um contador bom, que está ajudando com essas questões, e os fundos que já existem, que são alguns. Caso fundo socioambiental ajudou um projeto, e esse tipo de fundo já existe. Então, tem alguns, e vai ter muito mais. O gap que nós temos entre o BNDES e fundos muito pequenos vai desaparecer daqui a pouco. Não existe.
City and brought awareness to what was going on.
And so, you know, in terms of being able to set the narrative and counter the narrative that the government's trying to set, you could use art. I mean, it's a powerful tool. It's visible, because of course the government's here and everywhere else are all about appearances and what people see. So, you know, you can use your art to make people see what's really happening here and make sure that the right things are prioritized.
All right, thank you everybody. You can come to us if you have any other questions, if you want to keep the conversation going. You can find CAPCOM, you can find us, we're graduate school. We can change our name, Graduate Center for Planning and the Environment. My name is Nana Olvino Ponce, you can, I think, find me on the website. And you know, thank you again to UX and everybody who guided us throughout the week.